Hello everyone, welcome to Sarushi classes. So now let's start reading ncert class 8 history, that is chapter 2, that is from trade to territory. So the company establishes power. So Aurangzeb was the last powerful Mughal rulers, and he established control over a very large part of the territory that is now known as India. So after his death in 1707, many Mughal governors they were called as Subedars, and big Zamindars began asserting their authority and establishing regional kingdoms. So as the powerful regional kingdoms emerged in various parts of India, Delhi could no longer function as an effective center. So by the second half of the 18th century, however, a new power was emerging on the political horizons, the British. So did you know that the British originally came as a small trading company and were reluctant to acquire territories? So how then did they come to be masters of vast empire? So in this chapter, we will see how this came about. So here, and this is the image where the Bahadur Shah Zafar and his sons being arrested by Captain Hudson. So after Aurangzeb, there was no powerful Mughal ruler, but a Mughal emperor continued to be symbolically important. So in fact, when a massive rebellion against British rule broke out in 1857, Bahadur Shah Zafar, the Mughal emperor at the time, was seen as the natural leader. And once the revolt was put down by the company, Bahadur Shah Zafar was forced. Remember, Bahadur Shah Zafar was forced to leave the kingdom, and his sons were shot in cold blood. Now something about the East India Company. So East India Company comes east. So here is the British island, and here is the African continent, and here is the Indian subcontinent. So here you will see the path. Here is the Cape of Good Hope, and here is the Calicut, and the Madras, here is the Bombay. Okay, so they have shown the routes. So here are the routes to the India in the 18th century. So in the 16th century, the East India Company acquired a charter from ruler of the England, Queen Elizabeth I, granting it a sole right to trade with the East. So this means that no other trading group in England could compete with the East India Company. So with this charter, the company could venture across the oceans looking for new lands from which it could buy goods at a cheap price and carry them back to the Europe to sell at the higher prices. So the company did not have to fear competition from other English trading companies. Mercantile trading companies in those days made profit primarily by excluding competition so that they could buy cheap and sell dear. So what do you mean by a mercantile? Mercantile is a business enterprise that makes profit primarily through trade, buying goods cheap and selling them at higher prices. So this is nothing but a mercantile. So the Royal Charter, however, could not prevent other European powers from entering the Eastern market. So by the time the first English ship sailed down the west coast of Africa round the Cape of Good Hope and crossed the Indian Ocean, and the Portuguese had already established their presence in the western coast of the India and had their base in the Goa. So who are the first to come to India? They are Portuguese. So in fact, it was the Vasco da Gama, a Portuguese explorer, who had discovered this route to India in 1498, and by the early 17th century, the Dutch too were exploring the possibilities of trade in Indian Ocean. Soon the French traders arrived on the scene. So the problem was that all the companies were interested in buying the same things, and the fine qualities of cotton and silk produced in India had a big market in Europe. So pepper, clove, cardamom, cinnamon were in the great demand, and competitions among the European companies inevitably pushed up the prices at which these goods could be purchased, and this reduced the profits that could be earned And the only way the trading companies could flourish was by eliminating rival competitors. So the urge to secure market therefore led to fierce battles between the trading companies. Through the 17th and the 18th century, they regularly sank each other's ships, blockaded routes and prevented rival ships from moving with the supplies of goods. So trading was carried on with arms and trading posts were protected through fortification. Remember, trade was carried on with the arms and trade posts were protected with through fortification. So this efforts to fortify settlements and carry on the profitable trade also led to intense conflict with local rulers, and the company therefore found it difficult to separate trade from politics. So let us see how this happened. These efforts to fortify settlements and carry on profitable trade also led to intense conflict with local rulers, and the company therefore found it difficult to separate trade from politics. So let us see how this happened. So East India Company begins trade in the Bengal. So the first English factory was set up on the banks of River Hooghly in 1651. So this was the base for which the company traders, known as that time as the factors, operated, and the factory had a warehouse where the goods for exports were stored, and it had offices where company officials sat. So as trade expanded, the company persuaded merchants and traders to come and settle near the factory. By 1696, it began building a fort around the settlements, and 2 years later, it bribed Mughal officials into giving the company zamindari rights over 3 villages. So one of these was Kalikata, which later grew into the city of Calcutta or Kolkata, and it is known as Kolkata today. It is also persuaded the Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb to issue a farman granting the company the right to trade duty free. So what is the farman? Farman is nothing but a royal edict, a royal order. So a company tried continuously to press for more concessions and manipulate existing privileges. Aurangzeb's farman, for instance, had granted only the company the right to trade duty free. But officials of the company who were carrying on a private trade on the side were expected to pay duty. So this they refused to pay, causing an enormous loss of the revenue for Bengal. How could the Nawab of Bengal, Murshid Quli Khan, not protest? So this was the reason for the protest of Nawab of the Bengal, Murshid Quli Khan. So here you will see the figure that shows the local boats bring goods from ships in the Madras, and this is painted by William Simpson in 1867. So here is the picture of the famous Robert Clive. So how trade leads to the battle. So to the early 18th century, the conflict between the company and the Nawabs of the Bengal intensified after the death of the Aurangzeb, and the Bengal Nawabs asserted their power and autonomy. So as other regional powers were doing at that time, Murshid Quli Khan was followed by Ali Wali Khan and Siraj ud-Daulah as the Nawab of the Bengal. Now each one of them was a strong ruler, and they refused to grant the company concessions and demanded large tributes for company's right to trade, denied it any right to mint coins, and stopped it from extending its fortifications. So, accusing the company of deceit, they claimed that the company was depriving the Bengal government of huge amounts of revenue and undermining the authority of the Nawab. So it was refusing to pay taxes, writing disrespectful letters and trying to humiliate the Nawab and his officials. So the company on its part declared that the unjust demand of the local officials were ruining the trade of company, and trade could not flourish only if the duties were removed. So it was also convinced that to expand the trade, it had to enlarge its settlements by up villages and rebuilt its fort. So the conflicts led to confrontations and finally culminated in the famous Battle of Plassey. Let's discuss something about the Battle of Plassey. So when the Ali Wadi Khan died in 1756, Siraj ud-Daula became the Nawab of Bengal. Okay, Ali Wadi Khan died in the 1756 and then the Siraj ud-Daula became the Nawab of Bengal. Now the company was worried about his power and keen on a puppet ruler who would willingly give trade concessions and other privileges. So it tried, though without success, to help one of the Siraj ud-Daula's rival became the Nawab, and infuriated Siraj ud-Daula asked the company to stop meddling in the political affairs of his dominion, stop fortification and pay the revenues. After the negotiations failed, the Nawab marched with 30,000 soldiers to the English factory of Kasim Bazar. Captured the company officials, locked the warehouses, disarmed all Englishmen and blockaded English ships. So then he marched to the Calcutta to establish control over the company's fort there. So on hearing the news of the fall of Calcutta, company officials in Madras sent forces under the command of the Robert Clive. He played very important role. So, reinforced by naval fleets, prolonged negotiations with the Nawab followed, and finally in the 1757, Robert Clive led the company's army against Siraj ud-Daula at Plassey. So, one of the main reasons for the defeat of Nawab was that the forces led by Mir Jafar, one of the Siraj ud-Daula's commanders, never fought the battle. So Clive had managed to secure his support by promising to make him Nawab after crushing Siraj ud-Daula, and the Battle of Plassey became famous because it was the first major victory the company won in India. It is said that the Battle of Plassey is the battle which was never fought. So do you know the meaning of puppet? Puppet, literally a toy that you can move with the strings, and the term is used disapprovingly to refer to a person who is controlled by someone else. Now, did you know how Plassey got its name? Plassey is an anglicized pronunciation of Palachi, and the place derived its name from the palash. Palash tree, known for its beautiful red flowers that yield gulal, the powder used in the festival of Holy. Here is the picture. So the general courtroom, the East India House, Leadenhall Hall Street, and this is the court of proprietors of the East India Company, had their meetings in the East India House of the Leadenhall Street in the London, and this is a picture of one of their meetings in the progress. Now let us read this source, the promise of riches. So the territorial ambitions of the mercantile East India Company were viewed with the distress and doubt in England. After the Battle of Plassey, Robert Clive wrote to the William Pitt, one of the principal secretaries of the state to the English monarch, on the 7th of January 1759 from Calcutta. But so large of sovereignty may possibly be an object to extensive for a mercantile company, I flatter myself that there will be little or no difficulty in obtaining the absolute possession of these rich kingdoms, and now I leave you to judge whether an income yearly of 2 million sterling with the possession of 3 provinces be an object deserving the public attention. And here is the second source, the Nawab complaint. So in the 1733, the Nawab of the Bengal said this about the English traders. So when they first came into the country, they petitioned the 10th government in the humble manner for liberty to purchase a spot of ground to build a factory house upon, which was no sooner granted, but they built a strong fort, surrounded it with a ditch which has communication with the river, and mounted a great number of guns upon the wall. They have enticed several merchants and others to go and take protection under them, and they collect a revenue which amounts to 1 lakh. They rob and plunder and carry great number of things subject of both sexes into slavery into their own country. So let's read main topic. So after the defeat at Plassey, Siraj-ud-Daula assassinated and Mir Jafar made the Nawab as promised. So the company was still unwilling to take over the responsibility of administration. So its prime objective was expansion of the trade, and if this could be done without conquest through the help of local rulers who were willing to grant privileges, then territories need not be taken over directly. So soon the company discovered that this was rather difficult, for even the puppet Nawab were not always as helpful as the company wanted them to be. After all, they had to maintain a basic appearance of dignity and sovereignty if they wanted respect from their subjects, right? So what could the company do now? When Mir Jafar protested, the company deposed him and installed Mir Qasim in his place. So when Mir Qasim complained, he in turn was defeated in battle fought at Buxar in 1764, driven out of Bengal, and Mir Jafar was reinstalled. Now the Nawab had to pay rupees 5 lakh every month, but the company wanted more money to finance its wars and meet the demands of trade and its other expenses. Now it wanted more territories and more revenues. By the time Mir Jafar died in 1765, and the mood of the company had changed. Having failed to work with the puppet Nawabs, Clive declared, "We must indeed become Nawab ourselves." So finally, in the 1765, the Mughal Emperor appointed the company as a Diwan of provinces of Bengal. Now the Diwani allowed the company to use the vast revenue resources of Bengal, and this solved a major problem that a company had earlier faced. So from the early 18th century, it traded with India and had expanded, but it had to buy most of the goods in India with gold and silver imported from Britain. So this was because at this time, Britain had no goods to sell in India. Now the outflow of the gold from Britain slowed after a battle of Plassey, and entirely stopped after the assumptions of the Diwani. Now revenues from India could finance company's expenses, and these revenues could be used to purchase cotton and silk textile in India, maintain company troops, and meet the cost of the building and the company fort and offices at Calcutta. Now the company officials became Nawabs. So what did it mean to the Nawab? So it means, of course, that the company acquired more power and authority. But it also means something else. Each company servant began to have visions of living like Nawab. So after the Battle of Plassey, the actual Nawab of Bengal were forced to give land and vast sum of money as a personal gift to the company officials. Robert Clive himself, amazed to a fortune in India. He had come to Madras, now Chennai, from England in 1743 at the age of 18. When in 1767 he had left, his Indian fortune was 401 euros and 102 euros. No. It is 410102. That is 4 lakh. And 1,102 euros. So interestingly, when he was appointed governor of Bengal in 1764, he was asked to remove corruption. He was asked to remove the corruption in company administration, but he was himself cross-examined in 1772 by the British Parliament, which was suspicious of his vast wealth. So although he was acquitted, he committed suicide in 1774. However, not all company officials succeeded in making money like Clive. Many died an early death in India due to disease and war, and it would not be right to regard all of them as corrupt and dishonest. Many of them came from humble backgrounds, and their uppermost desires was to earn enough in India, return to Britain, and lead a comfortable life. So those who managed to return with the wealth led flashy lives and flaunted their riches. They were called Nawabs, and anglicized versions of the Indian word Nawab, and they were often seen as upstarts and social climbers in the British society, and were ridiculed or made fun of in plays and cartoons. So let's read the source number 3. How did Clive see himself? So at his hearing in front of a committee in the parliament, Clive declared that he had shown admirable restraint after the battle of Plassey. So this is what he said. So consider the situation in which the victory at Plassey had placed me. A great prince was dependent on my pleasure, an opulent city lay at my mercy, and its richest bankers stood against each other for my smiles, and I walked through vaults which were thrown open to me alone, piled on either hand with gold and jewels. Mr. Chairman, at this moment I stand astonished at my moderations. Now read something about the company rules expand. So if we analyze the process of annexation of the Indian states by the East India Company from 1757 to 1857, certain key aspects emerged, and the company rarely launched a direct military attack on unknown territory. Instead, it used a variety of political, economic, and diplomatic methods to extend its influence before annexing an Indian kingdom. So after the Battle of Buxar that happened in 1764, the company appointed residents in Indian states. They were political or commercial agents, and their job was to serve and further the interest of the company. Through the residents, the company officials began interfering in the internal affairs of the Indian states. They tried to decide who was to be the successor to the throne and who was to be appointed in the administrative post. Sometimes the company forced the states into the subsidiary alliance. So according to the terms of the subsidiary alliance, the Indian rulers were not allowed. Indian rulers were not allowed to have their independent armed forces, and they were to be protected by company but had to pay for the subsidiary forces. So that company was supposed to maintain for the purpose of this protection. So if the Indian ruler failed to make a payment, then the part of their territory was taken away as a penalty. For example, when the Richard Wellesley was the Governor General in the 1798 to 1805, the Nawab of Awadh was forced to give over a half of his territory to company in the 1801 as he failed to pay for subsidiary forces. The Hyderabad was also forced to cede territories on a similar ground. Here you will see the picture of Nawab Sirajuddaulah of Awadh with the sons and the British residents painted by Tilly Kettle. So the treaties that followed the Battle of Buxar forced Nawab Shuja-ud-Dawla to give up much of his authority. And here, however, he poses in the regal splendor towering over the resident. Now, let's read source number 4. So what power did resident have? So this was the James Mill, the famous economist and the political philosopher from Scotland, wrote about the residents appointed by a company. So we place a resident who really is king of the country, whatever injunctions of the non-interference he may act under. So as long as the prince acts in the perfect observance and does what is agreeable to the residents, that is to the British government, things go on quietly and they are managed without the resident appearing much in the administration of affairs. But when anything of a different nature happens, the moment the prince takes course which the British government thinks wrong, this then comes clashing and disturbances. So what do you mean by injunctions? Injunctions means the instruction, and subservience means the submissiveness. So next is the Tipu Sultan, the Tiger of Mysore. So here you will see his portrait, or you can see a painting. So the company resorted to direct military confrontation when it saw a threat to its political or economic interest. This can be illustrated with the case of the southern Indian state of Mysore. And Mysore had grown in strength under the leadership of powerful ruler like Hyder Ali, ruled from 1761 to 1782, and his famous son Tipu Sultan ruled from 1782 to 1799. Mysore controlled the profitable trade of the Malabar coast, where the company purchased pepper and cardamom, and in the 1785, the Tipu Sultan stopped the export of the sandalwood and paper and cardamom through the ports of his kingdom and disallowed local merchants from trading with the company. So he also established a close relationship with the French in India and modernized his army with their help. Now the British were furious and they saw Hyder and Tipu as ambitious, arrogant and dangerous rulers who had to be controlled and crushed. Four wars were fought with Mysore, that is 1767 to 69, then 1780 to 1784, then 1790 to 92, and 1799. So only in the last, that is the Battle of Seringapatnam, did the company ultimately win a victory. Tipu Sultan was killed defending his capital Seringapatnam. Mysore was placed under the former ruling dynasty of the Wadiyars, and subsidiary alliance was imposed on the state. So let's see this figure. So Cornwallis receiving the sons of Tipu Sultan as hostages, painted by the Daniel on 1793. So the company forces were defeated by the Hyder Ali and Tipu Sultan in several battles, but in 1792, attacked by the combined forces of Marathas, the Nizam of the Hyderabad and the company, Tipu was forced to sign a treaty with the British by which two of his sons were taken away as hostages. British painters always like painting scenes that show the triumph of British powers. Now, the legend of the Tipu. So here you will see Tipu's toy tiger. So this is the picture of the big mechanical toy that Tipu possessed. And you can see a tiger mauling a European soldier, and when its handle was turned, the toy tiger roared and the soldier shrieked. This toy tiger is now kept in the Victoria and Albert Museum in London. So the British took it away when Tipu Sultan died defending his capital Seringapatnam on 4th of May 1799. Now, kings are often surrounded by legend and their powers glorified through folklore. Now, here is a legend about the Tipu Sultan who became the ruler of Mysore in 1782. So it said that once he went hunting the forest with a French friend, there he came face to face with a tiger and his gun did not work and his dagger fell to the ground. So he battled with the tiger unarmed until he managed to reach down and pick up the dagger. Finally, he was able to kill the tiger in the battle, and after this he came to be known as Tiger of Mysore. He had the image of the tiger on his flag. Now, war with the Marathas. So from the late 18th century, the company also sought to curb and eventually destroy Maratha power. So with their defeat in the third battle of the Panipat in 1761, the Marathas' dream of ruling from Delhi was shattered and they were divided into many states under different chiefs belonging to dynasties such as Sindhya, Holkar, Gaikwad and Bhosle. So these chiefs were held together in the confederacy under a Peshwa. What do you mean by confederacy? Confederacy is nothing but the alliance. Under a Peshwa, that is the principal minister, became effective military and administrative head based in the Pune. So Mahadaji Sindhya and Nana Phadnis were the two famous Maratha soldiers and statesmen of the late 18th century. Remember, Mahadaji Sindhya and Nana Fadnis were the two most famous Maratha soldiers and statesmen of the late 18th century. Now, the Marathas were subdued in a series of wars. In the first war that ended in 1782 with the Treaty of Salbai, there was no clear victory. The second Anglo-Maratha war started in 1803 and lasted till 1805 was fought on the different fronts, resulting in the British gaining Orissa and the territories north of the Yamuna River, including Agra and Delhi. Finally, the third Anglo-Maratha war of 1817 to 1819 crushed the Maratha power, and the Peshwa was removed and sent away to the Bithur near Kanpur with a pension. The company now had complete control over the territories south of the Vindhyas. First, they have captured Bengal, then Hyderabad, then Mysore, that area, and now Marathas. Now, the claim of paramountcy. So, here you will see an image of the Lord Hastings. So, it is clear from above that from the early 19th century, the company pursued an aggressive policy of territorial expansions under the Lord Hastings, was the Governor General from 1813 to 1823. A new policy of paramountcy was initiated. Remember the name of Lord Hastings and a new policy of paramountcy. Now, the company claimed that its authority was paramount or supreme, and hence its power was greater than Indian states. In order to protect its interest, it was justified in annexing or threatening to annex any Indian kingdom. This view continued to guide later British policies as well. So, this process, however, did not go unchallenged. For example, when the British tried to annex the small state of Kittur in Karnataka today, Rani Chennamma took arms and laid anti-British resistance movement. She was arrested in 1824 and died in the prison in the 1829. So, by Rayanna, a poor chowkidar of the Sangoli in Kittur, carried on the resistance, and with the popular support, he destroyed many British camps. Remember, Rayanna, a poor chowkidar of the Sangoli in the Kittur, carried on the resistance, and with the popular support, he destroyed many British camps and records, and he was caught and hanged by the British in 1830. Okay, next is, in the late 1830s, the East India Company became worried about Russia. It imagined that Russia might expand across Asia and enter India from the northwest. Driven by this fear, the British now wanted to secure their control over the northwest, and they fought a prolonged war with the Afghanistan between 1838 and 1842 and established indirect company rule there. So, Sindh was taken over in the 1843. Now, Sindh was also taken. So, next in the line was Punjab, but the presence of Maharaja Ranjit Singh held back the company. After his death in 1839, two prolonged wars fought with the six kingdoms, and ultimately in the 1849, Punjab was also annexed. Now, next is the doctrine of labs, but before that, let us see this beautiful picture. Let's have a look at this beautiful picture. So, this is the Maharaja, this is the portrait of Maharaja Ranjit Singh holding a cord. So, this was about this painting. So, let's read about the doctrine of labs. So, the final wave of annexations occurred under a Lord Dalhousie, who was the Governor General from 1848 to 1856. He devised a policy that came to be known as the Doctrine of Labs. Now, the doctrine declared that if an Indian ruler died without a male heir, his kingdom would lapse, that is, became part of the company territory. one kingdom after another was annexed simply by applying this doctrine, like first Satara in 1848, then Sambalpur in 1850, then Udaipur in 1852, then Nagpur in 1853, and then Jhansi in 1854. Finally, in the 1856, the company also overtook the Awadh. This time, the British had an added argument. They said that they were obliged by duty to take over Awadh in order to free the people from the misgovernment of the Nawab, enraged by the humiliating way in which Nawab was deposed. Now, the people of Awadh joined the great revolt that broke out in the 1857. Now here, let's have a look at these maps. Like here is the Calcutta, and then here is the, first of all, they captured, the British captured this, what we can say, Bengal area, and then after they captured this area, and then Mysore, and then they captured this area, so, and then Punjab and all. So here is the, they have shown the expansion of the British territory, and here, so we can say that first of all they came here, they captured the Bengal area, then after they moved forward, and then here they captured the Mysore, and then Marathas, and then after the Sindh and Punjab. So let's discuss something about the setting up a new administration. So Warren Hastings, Governor General from 1773 to 1785, was one of the many important figures who played a significant role in the expansion of the company power. By his time, the company had acquired power not only in Bengal but also in the Bombay and Madras. Remember, by his time, the company had acquired the power not only in Bengal but also in the Bombay and Madras, and British territories were broadly divided into administrative units called presidencies. So there were the three presidencies, Bengal, Madras and Bombay, and each was ruled by the governor. So the supreme head of the administration was the Governor General. Warren Hastings was the first Governor General to introduce several administrative reforms, notably in the sphere of justice. So from 1772, a new system of justice was established. Each district was to have two courts, a criminal court, that is Fauzdari Adalat, and the civil court, that is Diwani Adalat. Now, Maulvis and the Hindu Pandits interrupted in the Indian laws for the European districts collectors who presided over the civil courts. The criminal courts were still under the Qazi. Qazi means a judge, and the Mufti, a jurist of the Muslim community responsible for expounding the law that Qazi would administer. But the under supervision of the collector. So what do we mean by impeachment? Impeachment is a trial by the House of the Lords in England for charges of misconduct brought against a person in the House of Commons. So here you will see the image, trial of Warren Hastings painted by the T.G. Pollard in 1789. So when Warren Hastings went back to England in the 1785, Edmund Burke accused him of being personally responsible for misgovernment of Bengal, and this led to an impeachment proceedings in the British Parliament that lasted 7 years. So let's read the source for you. I impeach the common enemy and oppressor of all. So here is the passage from the Edmund Burke's eloquent opening speech during the impeachment of the Warren Hastings. I impeach him in the name of the people of India, whose rights he had trodden under his foot and whose country he has turned into a desert. Lastly, in the name of human nature itself, in the name of the both the sexes, in the name of the every age, in the name of every rank, and I impeach the common enemy and the oppressor of all. Now, a major problem was the Brahmin Pandits gave different interpretations of the local laws based on the different schools of Dharma Shastra. So to bring about the uniformity in the 1775, 11 pandits were asked to compile a digest of Hindu laws. Now N.B. Hahn translated this digest into English. By 1778, a code of Muslim laws was also compiled for benefit of European judges, and under the Regulating Act of 1773, a new Supreme Court was established, while a court of appeal, the Sadar Nizamat Adalat, was also set up at Calcutta. Okay, so the principal figure in an Indian district was a collector. As the title suggests, his main job was to collect the revenue and taxes and maintain law and order in his district with the help of the judges, police officers and darogas. So his office, the collectorate, became the new center of the power and patronage that steadily replaced the previous holders of the authority. Now, Dharma Shastra. So the Sanskrit text prescribing social rules and codes of the behavior composed from 500 BCE onwards. So what do we mean by Savar? Savars are the men on horses and musket. Musket are a heavy gun used by infantry soldiers, and matchlock, an early type of gun in which the powder was ignited by a match. Let's read something about the company army. So colonial rule in India brought in some new ideas of administration and reform, but its power rested on its military strength. Now the Mughal army was mainly composed of cavalry. That is, Sawars trained soldiers on the horseback, and infantry, that is, paddle foot soldiers, they were given training in the archery, that is, Tir Andazi and use of sword. So the cavalry dominated the army, and Mughal state did not feel the need to have a large professionally trained infantry. Now, the rural areas had a large number of armed peasants, and local zamindars often supplied the Mughals with the paddle soldiers. So, a change occurred in 18th century when the Mughal successor states like Awadh and Banaras started recruiting peasants into their armies and training them as a professional soldiers. So, the East India Company adopted the same method when it began recruiting for its own army, which came to be known as a Sepoy army, from the Indian word Sipahi, meaning soldiers. So as warfare technology changed from 1820s, the cavalry requirements of the company army declined, and this is because the British Empire was fighting in Burma, Afghanistan and Egypt, where the soldiers were armed with the muskets and the matchlock. So what is the musket? Musket is a heavy gun used by the infantry soldiers, and the matchlocks are the early type of gun in which the powder was ignited by the match. Now the soldiers of the company army had to keep pace with the changing military requirements, and its infantry regiments now became more important. So in the early 19th century, the British began to develop a uniform military culture. Soldiers were increasingly subjected to European style training, drill and discipline, and that regulated their life for more than before. So often this created problems since caste and the community feelings were ignored in the building a force of the professional soldiers. So could individuals so easily give up their caste and religious feelings? Could they see themselves only as soldiers and not as a member of the community? So what did the sepoy feel? How did they react to changes in their lives and their identity? That is, their sense of who they were. And the revolt of 1857 gives us the glimpse into the world of the sepoys. So we are going to read it in the upcoming chapter. So here you will see a picture, a Savar of Bengal in a service of the company, painted by the unknown Indian artist in the 1780s. So after the battles with the Marathas and the Mysore rulers, the company realized the importance of strengthening its cavalry. Now at conclusion, we can say that thus the East India Company was transformed from a trading company to a territorial colonial power, and the arrival of new steam technology in the early 19th century also aided this process. Till then, it would take anywhere between 6 and 8 months to travel to India by the sea, and steam ships reduced the journey time to the 3 weeks, enabling more Britishers and their families to come to a far off country like India. By 1857, the company came to exercise direct rule. By 1857, the company came to exercise direct rule over about 63% of the territory and 78% of the population of the Indian subcontinent. Combined with its indirect influence on the remaining territories and population of the country, The East India Company had virtually the whole of India under its control. Elsewhere, slave trade in the South Africa. So what was happening in Africa during that time? The Dutch trading ships reached Southern Africa in the 17th century. Soon a slave trade began and the people were captured, chained and sold in the slave market. So slavery ended in 1834. There were 36,774 privately owned slaves at the Cape, located at the southernmost tip of the Africa. A visitor to the Cape in 1824 has left a moving account of what he saw at the slave auction. So having learned that there was to be a sale of cattle, farm stock, etc. by auction, we halted our wagon for the purpose of procuring the fresh oxen. Among the stock was a female slave and her three children. The farmers examined them as if they had been so many head of cattle. They were sold separately and to different purchasers. The tears, the anxiety, the anguish of the mother while she cast her a heart-rending look upon her children, and the simplicity and the touching sorrow of the poor young ones while they clung to their distracted parent, contrasted with the marked insensitivity and jocular countenance of the spectators. So this quoted in the Nigel Worden et al's The Chain That Binds Us, A History of Slavery at the Cape in 1996. So with this, we have come to an end of this chapter. Do subscribe to our channel for more such lectures. Thank you.